Good afternoon. Right now it is 5:52 p.m. Eastern Standard USA time, Georgia, East Coast, March 25th, 2019. Welcome to Real TV. And if you don't know, well, now you know, I am your host, Michael Israel of Real TV. Today's show is going to be called Your Power Can Change Lives. That's what we're going to call today's show. I want to start off with a couple of shout-outs real quick. And then we'll get into a short praise break. And we'll explain why in just a minute. And then we'll get into the show after that break. And we'll try to finish up. I probably am not going to do not on the mainstream news today. had a long night in the early morning. So I haven't had much time to take care of business, but this is just as business, just as the other business I need to take care of. In fact, I find it more important. So first is first, I want to give a few shout outs and in no particular order. I feel that it's always, before I even give this, it's right that you show love, you know what I mean? And I appreciate the love that's shown, because when I started this show, I was so shy and timid. Like, if you listen to when I first started the podcast, you'll hear my tone is so block-like, whereas now it's more like a circle. Now I'm more like fluid. I can roll here. I can pause. I can, you know what I mean? I'm more fluid, and I'm still developing. I'm no means where I would want to be, but just like life, it's just one day at a time, and that's with everything. So with that being said, I just want to give back just as much as you have given, because putting these videos together is not easy. It looks easy when it's all put together, but there's so much information that is not, it's okay. There's so much information that doesn't even make the cut. There's so much information that doesn't even make the cut. I mean, you have to gather some of the things that people can easily interpret, but you have to find those things. You have to chop it up. You have to listen to it, make sure it line up. You have to look for sound effects that sound pretty cool, if you're into that, and you have to find the visuals that make sense. You have to blend it all in together. And then you have to make it all make sense and talk about it and show how the scripture is indeed true, Not only that, once it's all said and done, you have to review it all and make sure it's all, tight knit. So a video that typically takes, let's just say, 15 minutes can take 3 to 4 days to prepare with life, with everything else going on. A video that takes an hour long video can take a week, or so, with piecing it together in life, if you catch my drift. So it's no easy task, and there's been times where, it's been tough, and then I'll see some words of joy, some words of wisdom, or shout out on a particular scene, or something that made you laugh, something that made you smile, something that changed in your life, and it inspires me, which it inspired you, and iron sharpeneth iron. So with all that, in so many words, in no particular order. Shout out to AC Israel. Shout out to Hirkiner. I want to give some newcomers some love and let you know it's all about y'all too. That's new to the show. If this is your first day, shout out to you too. You know, with YouTube changing their marketing strategy and becoming a more of a tight-knit brand, is certain things that they're going to do that they're not, you know what I mean? It's going to be a new paradigm, and things are changing. So, you're not brought to this show just by chance because you just happen to stumble over. That's not how things work. When you understand the spirit and you understand the signs around you and whatever you're going through, or, you know, the fact it's not an algorithm, okay? If you're brought to the show, you were not brought by an algorithm, though the algorithms exist, if you catch my drift. I hope I'm not confusing you. But it is the spirit that leads. It is the spirit that shows us, the Holy Spirit, the Most High, who puts it upon our hearts to understand the certain symbology in life. All right? So, right along. Also, I want to shout out to Goody MFLA. Okay? Also to Yasmin Daniels. What's up? Let's see. Royal Warrior. All right. How you doing? Hooks and Beats. Brit _ 365. Maria F. Let's see, who else we have? Who else we have here? Carry on Weber. How you doing? What's up? How you doing? Shalom. Kenny Wilburn. What's up, Ken? Fio Diente. Cyril. Pardon me, I know I'm going a little slow here. I want to get these names right, and I'm just sifting through. I can't get everybody. It's impossible. Right now, the numbers, I'm still in a ha. I am still in a ha over the amount of listeners and viewers that are tuning into the show. So I can't name everyone, but Linda McCoy, E. Severa, Awakening One, okay, where we at? Moise Gustave. Nedra Rutherford. Sydney Wright. May the Most High bless you. May the Most High bless all y'all. The Oracle. I hear you. Birder King. Man, it's a lot. I really want to. I'm missing a lot of people. I just can't. Dang. Miss Ladybug. Jessica Uvet. Christ Robertson. Deanna Alvarez. Marley Harris. Nineteen-oh-three Lola. Executive woman. Man, it's a lot. All right, let me go ahead and finish up here because we won't. All right, Alexia Mora. Let me see if I can cram a few more in here. Gabby J, Anastasia Maria. Egypt, Nephthys. James Jordan, Longy Fee Phi, AB, A Anonymous, dang, all right, y'all, and lastly, SLX. I can't get to everyone. I know that was a little long-winded, but you all took some time to give love to me, show love. So it is what it is. I can't get to everyone, but may the Most High bless all y'all, you know, and keep coming through. You know, hopefully my power will change your life, and we'll get into that a little bit later and break it down. But what I want to talk about now, really quick, and we'll take a little praise break, is a scripture coming from Psalm 96. I used to say Psalms, and when I was younger, when I thought it was Palms, but it's actually Psalm. It's not Psalms with an S. Some may say that let's change to the Book of Psalms. No, it's not Psalms. It's actually Psalm. It's just like the book Revelation. It's Revelation, not Revelations. You know, there's 66 books in the Bible that we know today. All right? It divides from Old Testament to New Testament. All right? You have... All right, let me not go too far. Okay. Right now, we're in the book of Psalm, chapter 96. We're going to read the whole way down to the 13th verse, and then we're going to go into praise break. Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord, all the earth. Sing unto the Lord, bless his name. Shew forth his salvation from day to day. So show him love every day. Sing unto the Lord a new song. All the earth, everybody, you, me, when you singing in the shower, when you're on the street, when you're in your car, when you sing from your heart, the Lord hears that. The Lord loves that. The angels go crazy over that because they're looking at us in awe. They're looking at us as a mentor. They're looking at us like, and they're looking at us in astonishment that we are living by faith and we have never seen or even been around the true presence of the Lord. Declare his glory among the heathen. So a heathen is an irreligious person. So we have to declare his glory among the heathen. His wonders among all people. So we have to talk about him. And let the irreligious people know. Let the atheists know. Let the people who believe in Darwinism know. You know, that's what one of the reasons why YouTube is a good platform. Even though as much as I am planning to have my own network in the works, right now I have some attorney things I have to correct with, as far as the brand and the site setup and all this stuff. It's a lot that goes into it to make it my own. So until the time being, this is what it is. And YouTube is helping with, you know, this glory of our Heavenly Father being known to the heathen. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Given to the Lord, O ye kindreds of the people. Given to the Lord glory and strength. Given to the Lord the glory due in his name. Bring an offering and come into his court. Worship the Lord in the beauty of his holiness. Fear before him all the earth. Say among the heathen that the Lord reigneth. The world also shall be established, that it shall not be moved. He shall judge the people righteously. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar and the fullness thereof. Let the field be joyful and all that is therein. Then shall all the trees of the wood rejoice. You know, just read that. Let me read that one more time. Then shall all the trees of the wood rejoice. The scripture is true. Have you ever seen Snow White? Or what is it? Snow White and the Seven Doors, or Little Red Riding Hood, and they're going through the forest and the trees are waving and they got a face, like a mean face, roar, and all this stuff. That these, man, the trees and plant life are full of life also. We may not think they move and that they have no sense of gusto within their, you know what I mean? But what they display in the cartoons is true. We haven't seen it, but when it say every knee shall bow, when the Heavenly Father comes down on the clouds and it comes to the earth, every knee shall bow. When it means every knee shall bow, that's exactly what it means. It's not just humans. It's going to be the whales. It's going to be the ants. It's going to be the birds. It's going to be the flamingos. It's going to be the lions. Everything. Everything. Every knee shall bow. The snake ain't got no knee. The snake might, I don't know how it's going to do. Everything's going to bow. The waves are going to bow. The trees are going to bow. The grass is going to bow. The flowers is going to bow. Everything. It sounds like science fiction, but it's true. Before the Lord, for he cometh to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the people with his truth. We're going to get into praise break. And then I'm going to take a short break. And we're going to talk about how your power can change lives. This song is something that came from the heart. I use the auto-tune and I just poured out my heart into the Heavenly Father. So you have to listen carefully to understand what my heart was singing. It's called Psalm 96, chapter 1.
And give the Most High, and give him the praise. and forever and always. And thank you, Yahweh, you and I have to give you praise. Yeshua, you died for me. You were hung on a tree. Lord, forgive me my sins. Lord, forgive me for my sins. I'm wrong for what I did. I'm wrong for what I've done. I know that you're the one for me, the only one. And a lot of times, we don't sing. So I sing this song for you.
Yeah, you know, maybe one day you'll awake, or maybe you're already awoken, but don't run away from the truth. We need the truth. Don't run away from the truth. Run the race all the way to the end. Run the race all the way to the end. Spending money, not the only thing we need to do. Giving money to the poor is what we need to do. A lot of lies in this world, but we need the truth. I know you wanna run away, but we need the truth. I know you wanna run away, but we need the truth. It's like we living in the cage, living in the zoo. Why you wanna run away when we need the truth? Why you wanna run away when we need the truth? Again, I thank you for tuning in. I hope you're enjoying the show so far. Nevertheless, on Real TV, we still gotta do the thing. Let's go! Yeah. Yeah. Our praise go to the Most High. And if you don't know, now you know. Passover's coming up soon. I hope you're ready. Because I'm ready to eat. Today's show is called Your Power Can Change Lives. You got to know that. Yeah. You got to know that. Got to know. Yeah. Let's get to it. Let's get to it. Okay. Ah, there we go. So, the show is called Your Power Can Change Lives. Heavenly Father, I pray unto you right now to bless those with an ear that hear. I don't know what I'm about to say right now, but Lord, bless my heart, bless my soul, bless these words, that you have for me to say. I'm not a preacher by no means, but there's something that I read that made sense to me that I just want the people to see. And for those who already see it, I just want us to look at it together and be in awe and point at it. So much so that everybody else can see the same thing in the sky and we all be in awe of your glory. So Lord, we want to glorify you today with this message because it is your power that is implemented into us that we shall shudder and tether with one another. So Lord, bless today, and we thank you for the life you have given us. We're trying to do right, and we're working out our salvation that we may get to heaven and live with you forever. Amen. Okay. I'm not a preacher, but about today's world, if Yeshua preached the same message the ministers preach today, he would have never been crucified. Because a lot of the stuff that's being preached right now is a lot of prosperity preaching. ATMs in the back. If you sow a seed, you'll be blessed. They're not telling us who we are. They're wearing obsessive makeup and halter tops and spaghetti strap tops and mini skirts. And dudes still wearing a bottle of cologne. You know, I mean, we can't, they're not telling us the basics. And it's the little things that add up that can be big things. And we all need a revival. We all need a revival. The only reason we don't have a revival is because we're willing to live without it. We think that life is just fine without one. But just as a lawnmower can fail when it's time to mow the grass, you may pull the string a couple of times and you get going. And as soon as you get going, it dies down. But then you have to prime it. You have to revive that lawnmower in order to get the juice back. You know what I mean? Sometimes when your phone is too hot and it's at 3%, you know your phone is good, but you got to revive it. You have to plug it in, let it chill, do its thing, and then it's revived. When you're tired, you had a long day, or just as we all need to get sleep, we have to shut down our biological computer and let it rest so we can be revived. Well, in the same sense, when we're in this evil world and there's so much going on in our lives and we have sins that we need to iron out, we are basically reviving ourselves. We are trying to be revived so we can live without that and have our full potential. I want to try to keep this under an hour. But I'm going to try to the best of my ability to break down what I want you to understand. All right. Let me give you a life story. I had a situation that on the job, I had to straighten out. Now, growing up in the hood, we're raised, you ain't no snitch. You're not to be no snitch. Don't tell, nothing like that. So, as a man, I can't speak for all men, but I can speak for black men in general. That, pardon me, Let me get some water real quick. All right, hopefully, hold on. Hopefully you didn't hear me gulp like crazy. Hope you didn't hear me like gulp like a pool. gulp like a hole in a pool. I can't speak for everybody, but for black men, we're raised not to snitch, right? We're raised, you know what I mean? Don't be a rat. So, in so many words, at the job, there's a manager that didn't go about things the right way. So, there's a guest who came down, and I spoke with her, and I asked her, how was her stay going, you know, in the city? And, you know, she said it was going good, and then she brought up one thing. She said, but last night I ordered shrimp and grits, and I ordered a Mac Daddy, which is like a macaroni and cheese dish, right? She said that the order took 40 minutes to get up. Now, I don't know the quote time that they took it up. You know, I was just so in tune of listening to her. And when it was my time to speak, you know, it slipped past me to ask her the exact time, the exact quote time, right? All right, so she said she ordered a meal. She said it took 40 minutes to get up. She said when she ordered the meal that, you know, it was busy in a dining area. But she didn't want to complain about the coldness of the food because she was tired, you know, and it was late. So, you know, I'm listening to her, and then, you know, I do my spiel. And in essence, basically what I said was, to shorten it, I said something along the lines of, you know, Miss, you know, thank you, you know, so much for telling me. I apologize. These are not our standards. You know, I've been here for blase time, and this is not how we do things. And, you know, I'm sorry you had to go through that. I apologize that you had to experience that. And I apologize that you had to experience that. And when we bring up the food, you know, it should be up. It comes hot. You know, it's warm to the touch. You should see steam in the container. You know, so, you know, I'm trying to soften the blow or whatever. And I said something along the lines of, you know, thank you so much for telling me. You know, I'm going to talk with the chef about that, and we're going to see what's going on. And, you know, don't worry about that meal. You know, I'll take care of that meal, so you don't have to worry about that. You know, we'll take that off your bill. You know, that's going to be on me. That's on us. We'll take care of that. You know, again, I apologize. You know, thank you for telling me. I'm going to let the chef know. And, you know, don't worry about that, whatever. And this, she came down, she was telling me this while she was eating her meal. So, all right. I go and tell the chef. I'm like, chef, you know, this lady, blase. I went through the experience, blah, blah, blah. Food was cold, and, you know, I comped her meal. And then the chef is like, hold on, what do you mean you comped her meal? Is that, so now you're messing with my sales. Now you're messing with my food costs. It's busy at the time. I don't have time to deal with this. I know what I did was the right move, and that's how you handle business. So and I was just like, you know, oh, okay, you know, and I went about my business, you know what I mean? So now what happened is the chef is starting to feel some type of way. I have an order that I have to take up to a room. And in this order, I know this story seems long-winded, but if you listen to me, I'm going to get to the point. All right. The order was a pancake meal and an omelet. With this particular setup, all the pancake type meals are made in the kitchen, and all the omelet meals are made on this open face cook style station, where the employees can perform for the guests, you know, and basically cook in front of the guests. Well, we make all the, you know, more complex dishes in the back, right? So this head chef was in the front cooking the omelet dish. All right. So I got the guy in the back making the pancakes, and I say to the chef, you know, hey, I need a everything omelet. He's quiet. He's sitting with his backside against the cook station. Now, this is an open buffet area, okay? And luckily, no guests were out where they could see. But he was on his phone with his backside against the buffet bar and on his phone, just looking down, just completely ignored me, didn't acknowledge me anything. So I'm like, you know, I'm thinking to myself, you know, it's just business. It didn't faze me in a way. I'm like, oh, okay, you know, it's business. You know, he's on his phone. He'll get to it. You know, it is what it is. How we do. All right, so whatever. So 4 minutes pass. Now the pancake meal is up in the window. I got to run this food and take it out. And he hasn't made the omelet meal yet. I say, you know, blase, blase, man. I call him by his name. Hey, you know, I need this omelet meal. He ignores me. He doesn't say anything. Doesn't acknowledge me. Still on his phone. He's an executive sous chef. This is someone who's right underneath the head chef, right? Okay. He doesn't make the meal. He doesn't make the meal. So I go in the back. I get the chef who made the pancake. Hey, can you make this meal for me? Blase, blase, didn't make the meal. I don't know why. I asked him twice. I don't know why he's ignoring me. I don't know what's going on. Can you make this meal for me, please? He hands me a pan. I go out front by the omelet station. I get the ingredients. I bring it back. The guy who made the pancakes makes the omelet. I take it up. As I'm coming out the kitchen, I say it loud enough where the guy who's still on his phone with his backside against the bar, I say to the guy who made both meals, hey, thanks for making this meal for me. You know, I said in a kind way, went up. I come back down. This quote-unquote sous chef, executive sous chef, is now sitting on the buffet bar. I'm talking about with the part where all the food is, where he's sitting, literally sitting on the buffet bar. I am shocked, you know, and I'm not going to say anything to him. We're men. There's cameras. I got a job to do, so I'm going to let it be. Okay. Now, I didn't want to be a snitch because now you're interfering with my work. Previously, we had a dish that was cold that I solved this problem. This is what I'm thinking to myself. I'm not saying this to him literally, but I'm thinking to myself, we had a meal that we had an issue with that was cold. Now, you're causing an issue for another cold dish. Why are you tripping about these quote-unquote food costs, about a shrimp and grits that... And some macaroni and cheese that may cost $25, $30. When you can just comp that versus losing a couple thousand dollars over a room. Because, you know, the room rates run anywhere between $300 to $600 a night. Okay? And why lose thousands over a $30 issue that can be fixed, an apology, a sincere apology, and maybe a gift card to come back and have lunch or breakfast or dinner on us. As a chef, why didn't you, I'm thinking to myself, go over there and talk to her? All right, so many words. The lady was getting ready to check out the next day. She get ready to check out, and she seems distraught. I wanted to go and talk with her and see, you know, make sure everything was okay, but I told her everything was okay. I spoke with some other people to make sure that particular meal was comp, and I knew it was taken care of. So I didn't want to go over there. She had on the shade. She looked like she was pissed. Now what happened is the valet lost her car, and they took 20 to 30 minutes to find her car. So now you have another issue on top of issue. So now it's a snowball effect. Okay, so what I did to get to him, I asked if this person who was above him, if they worked the next day, and which he responded, yeah, they did, right? Okay, so now I just wanted to put it in the air like I was going to kind of like snitch. I never did this in my life, you know what I mean? But you're interfering with my job. You know, this has to be, it has to be talked about. And this is another thing. If you have issues that you're going through at your job and you feel afraid, you're scared, you need to speak up. Don't be afraid of going through the hood policy. Don't snitch. Don't tell. Now, within means, you have to be in the spirit and you got to use wisdom. If the situation is small, you know, gauge it. But if it's a situation that's pretty big or something that's been going on for a while that's interfering with the way you're doing with work or the company's policy, that it may hinder your job or hinder you from doing your job, then you have to talk about it. And if you don't, you know what I mean, your situation may never get heard, and then you are carrying this burden that could have been dealt with. So you have the power to change lives. If you say something, you can change your life because somebody else will have the power to say something that can change the whole situation, that could change everybody's life. That person may get fired. That person may just get reprimanded. And then they may understand, and then they change. And then you happy. So now, you know, you're going through that change. All right, so today I go into work. And this guy's a no-call, no-show. We're talking about an executive chef that has great attendance. I'm thinking, oh, Lord, I hope nothing is wrong with him. You know, I hope nothing happened. You know what I mean? Because, you know, all I wanted was justice, you know? And I'm thinking, like, man, he's always showed to work on time, blah, 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 and this and that, and always getting on to other people within his team about being on time. And he's a no-call, no-show. You know, it says a lot. Like, the Most High worked it out. Like, I didn't even have to go to seniority and speak about the situation. We have the power to change lives. And I just wanted to give you that life story to kind of give you an example of what I mean. And I'll give you some other examples in just a moment. But before that, let me give you the scripture. And then we'll go into some examples and we'll close. All right, I want to keep this under an hour, and we are at about 45 minutes. So, we're reading from John chapter 9. We're going to read from John chapter 9, and we're going to start at verse 1, and we're just going to finish out that whole chapter 9. Drink some water there. Oh my goodness. Okay. John chapter 9 verses 1 through 15. Real quick. And as Yeshua passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. And all his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Yeshua answered, Neither had this man sinned nor his parents, but that the works of the Heavenly Father should be made manifest in him. I must work the works of him that sent me. While it is day, the night cometh, when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had thus spoken, he had spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with clay and said unto him, Go, wash in the pool of Siloam. He sent his way, therefore, and washed and came seeing. The neighbors, therefore, and they which before had seen him, that he was blind, said, Is it not he that sat and begged? Some said, This is he. Others said, He is like him, But he said, I am he. Therefore said they unto him, how were thine eyes open? He answered and said, a man that is called Yeshua made clay and anointed my eyes and said unto me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. And I went and washed, and I received sight. Then they said unto him, where is he? He said, I know not. They brought to Pharisees him that aforetime was blind. And it was the Sabbath day when Yeshua made the clay and opened his eyes. Then again, the Pharisees also asked him, how had he received the sight? He said unto him, he put clay on my eyes and washed and do see. The scripture also mentions in another part of the book that greater things we should do. We have the power to change lives, but technology in this world has, pardon me, taken us to a place where they are training the world to not have faith. If someone is blind, and if someone is really holy, that person is really holy, should be able to spittle clay, put it over someone's eye, and tell them to wipe it off, or however they do it. The scripture says, greater things we shall do in his name. If someone breaks their arm, we should be able to touch their arm and they're healed. There is a story where a woman was just trying to touch the hem of Yeshua's garment, and she was healed. She didn't even touch him, but she was just trying to touch the very part, the lowest part of his garment, and barely almost touched it. And he said, who touched me? It is the faith within us that can change the power. I mean, the power can be bestowed upon us from our Heavenly Father to do his will in this world. Just as much as, see, that's the miracle part. But we should be able to do those things. But we're so far away from faith. We're not living right. We don't believe enough. You know what I mean? We're not fasting and praying enough, so we can't do anything. So anything that's wrong is go to the doctor. It's you need to get surgery. It's we should be able to heal by the touch of the hand. The scripture says when a man is sick or someone is sick, you take them to the elders, and the elders shall pray and lay hands on him, and then he should be healed. But ain't nobody's believing in that anymore. I'm not talking about no Billy Haney swinging his cape and people flying in the air, man. That stuff, get out of here, man. This is propaganda. That's propaganda. I'm talking about the real deal right now. And that's just the miracle version of power. We have the power to speak up. We have the power to do right. And just by being an example, that power within you can change somebody's life. It's like a tether. It's like tethering a phone. You get your phone, and I get my phone, and we press a button, and we could tether each other's phone, and that power can put power to my phone. You know what I mean? We're exchanging information. The Rock on Indiana Jones had to roll somehow. It was the Rock that got power from the hill that it was on. You know what I mean? That propelled it to go down and as fast as it did. You know, it's like the waves in the ocean tether off of one another. You know, birds of a feather flock together. It's the mechanics of a bicycle all work in unison. You understand? The wheels, the front wheel coincides with the back wheel. But then you got the brakes. Then you got the spokes. You have the handles. It's not only the bike, but it's the energy from the legs, the foot, the ankle, the toe, the mind. You know what I mean? Your strength. Did you eat breakfast? Do you have enough strength to pedal? You know, it's a lot of... Your power can change lives. and being an example for someone, as a child, were you not inspired when you were like 5 years old, you're just watching to see how people eat, and then they catch you watching them eat, and you smile, you look away, and you like, and eventually you start trying to chew like them, or you see somebody, and you try walking like them, or you're in the city, and you see a nice outfit, and you're like, oh, I like that outfit. I'm gonna put that and that together. I like those colors. I need to go buy it. Where'd you get that from? It's not necessarily their clothes or power, but it was something that influenced you. Sometimes the way that we talk, some of the words that we pick, just subconsciously and psychologically pick up within our mind, and we end up saying it. So it was something within them that was a part of their power that influenced us, that changed our life. We're talking like our voice is a complex of who we grew up around. Our thoughts is a complex of all the information that we ever learned. I hope this is making sense. It's like if we were to go to Africa and we were on a mission trip and we went to feed the hungry, but the people in Africa didn't have water. So because they have malnutrition, we who are healthy and who have made better structure and who have more access to vitamins and supplements before we came to Africa and who have the energy, we decide that we're going to go on a voyage and we're going to take the 5 mile trip to the other city to go to the well, pump water, and we're going to walk 5 miles back because the transportation is limited. So we have to go by foot, and we're going to go as a group to go bring water to the village. So we get to the village and we're feeding the children the water on this hot summer day. And the child is drinking the water. So as a gift, the mothers in the village are making rice and beans, let's say. So they hand us the rice and beans, and we hand them the water. It's like when we hand them the water, it's like that's a blessing for us in itself, to give them the water, because we know that they need it. And it's like we don't need anything. Like, we're here to help you. But them giving us a bowl of rice and beans when they're dying of thirst, like they really need the water. That infant with a bloated stomach needs the water, and he gives you the cup back, like, here, have a sip. Like, you feel bad because, you know what I mean? That little gesture, that little influence is going to change your life for the rest of your life. You know what I mean? It's like, sometimes when you're generous people, we give to see the impossible become possible. I want to say that one more time. Generous people give to see the impossible become possible. Generous people give to see the impossible become impossible. When a person's car is down and their hood is popped, and you see that person needs help because their battery is low and you got some cables in the trunk, you may stop over, and you know by faith and through common sense that if I put these cables on this battery with their battery and my battery, okay, and turn the ignition, we can get this car started. This car that failed can now become possible. You know what I mean? This impossible battery that we thought was completely dead can now become filled with power. Let me give you an example. Another example real quick. Today, this show inspired me because there's this poor guy. You could tell he's young. He's very young. He looks like 16, literally. And I see him by my job, and he digs through the trash cans, and he looks for food. He goes to the different trash cans and pluck for food and look for cups to drink out of that people thrown in. And when I go home, you know, I see him here and there, and I be wanting to give money to him when I have it, but I don't be wanting to do it publicly because there's a lot of people. But it's like, what's in me, I have to give regardless of who's around, because I know for a fact that he's poor. And then you see people with around the city, and they have on slacks, gaiters, and a collar shirt and a poster board, and they have a sign that says, please help me with my insulin. And they got a notebook, like they're filling out applications. For one, I'm thinking, okay, where you get the gaiters from? How come your slacks have creased? You know, you look cleaned up. I'm not saying you're not poor, but right now you're looking better off than this guy that is digging through the trash can. Where'd you get the markers to write the poster? How come you got a clean cut? You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying you can't be clean and poor, but for a fact, I know this guy is poor because I'm led by the Spirit. And common sense, when you're led by the Spirit, you know when to give and who to give. Or you'll see the hobos, the people that are ride on the trains, jump trains. And they got dogs. I'm thinking, okay, all right, y'all rolling in a 10-pack, and then y'all got like three dogs in a group. How are y'all rolling and staying? I mean, something's going on, man. So I was led by the Spirit, and I'm walking and, you know, taking care of business. And, you know what I mean? Along the way, I disregarded the hobos. The Spirit was like, nah, you saved this money for the guy you said you was going to give it to all this week. I passed by them. And I was like, man, I wish I could see this kid. So I ended up seeing the kid, and I stopped. And I said, hey, I got something for you. And he stopped. And I pulled out the money. At first, I looked over my shoulders, looked around real quick to see if anybody was looking at it, because I hate doing the public thing. You know what I mean? I don't want to do it like I'm doing it. You know what I'm saying? So I gave it to him anyway. A five slipped out. And I'm like, nah, I got something bigger for you. Hold on one sec. Man, I gave him everything in my pocket. And I'm not saying that to be boastful. I'm just telling you what's real. This is real TV. All right? This is not about no boasting. This is just fact of what happened. I gave him everything in my pocket. But it's not just about giving and dipping. You got to give, and you should talk to the people. Talk to these people. See what's going on. So I asked him. I said, hey, man, because just think, they're going around asking. And here's the thing. He never asked for money, ever. He's just digging in the trash can, eating food, and stuff like that, man. All right? Man, yo, I asked my man. I talked with them because these people are human, too. Just imagine poor people just asking, poor people are really poor, just asking people for money all day, and nobody's talking to them, but everybody dropping something in the jar, and they ain't got no phone, they ain't got no computer, ain't nobody saying hello, ain't nobody really talking to them. Can you imagine how that feels, and you're poor every day? Anyways, I asked my man, I said, what's your name, man? And he told me his name. He said, Frederick William something. He told me his whole name, but I like to go by William, but you call me Frederick, or you call me Fred, or William, you know, whatever. I said, man, are you poor? And he said, yes. And I said, what happened? He said that my family lost our home because of Hurricane Irma, and then we were staying in a hotel, and we ran out of money for a hotel, and we had to leave. And I said, man, he looks so young. I said, man, how old are you, man? He said, I'm 20. And I said, because I want to do something. I want to help him. You know what I mean? I hate the fact of just giving. Because once you give, then they always have to ask. Why can't we just help them do something? Learn to trade. Go buy a rake and a few bags. And be like, here, bro, I give you a rake. I give you these bags. And I can help you on these first two or three houses. And rake some leaves, man. We can knock on doors, ask for a donation, you know what I mean? And then the rest you're on your own. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to just give because they always going to have to ask. I'd rather put you on and then you're able to make money for yourself. You feel me? All right, so I'm talking to Fred. Well, he liked to go by William, but I'm talking to William, and after I asked him his age, man, I said, man, how come you? I said, you ever thought about looking to a job or can you work? He said, yeah. You know, he got excited then, eyes open big. He said, yeah. When I was back home, I was working at the Waffle House. It was me and my sister. I know how to wash dishes. See, I wash dishes, and you know, I'm good at that. My sister, though, she wasn't so good at serving, but she didn't do too good. And you know, it's me, my sister, and my mom. I said, "Where do you live? I mean, how do you live? You got a house, or you know, what I mean, where do you go?" He said, "I live at a camp. They live under a bridge in these little camps down here, and they don't have money. They trying to leave the city." He said that we're trying to leave, and I said, "So you know how to do dishes?" I'm like, "Okay," and I said, "All right, man. Here's what I can do. If you know how to do dishes, right now, we're looking for a dishwasher. And I've been w with this company going on almost 10 years. And in the eyes of the company, I'm an all right employee. I can put in a good word for you. If this is something that you're interested in, we do have a dishwasher position. And it's not much, but it can start you off at about $10 an hour. It's full time. I could get you probably evening shifts starting at about maybe 3 to 10 or 3. It may cap out at about 10:30, maybe 11, depending on if it's a big event or something like that. He's like, yeah, I know. And if it's like, I was like, all right, I could do that on my end. And I'm thinking to myself, the spirit is like, be wise, be wise. You need to be circumspect. Be circumspect. Okay? So I'm listening to the spirit. And I was like, but because I don't know him from a can of paint. I just see him digging in the trash can, looking for food. You know, I don't know his criminal history. You know, I don't know what's what, you know. But I'm being led by the spirit. So I say, but I can do that on my end, but what I would need you to do is if, because I mean, he's ruffled, his clothes are poor, his fingernails are extremely dirty, you know, his facial hair is completely rugged, which is nothing wrong with it. His hair is uncombed. I mean, you know, he was poor, you know, he was poor, all right. And I say, but on your end, I'm gonna need you to, if you could put a resume together, you know, about your job history or something, or if you could put that Waffle House experience on a sheet of paper, even if you have to go to the library and do it, you know, if you could do that on your end, I could do this on my end and put on good where I said, are you normally in the city during the day? And because, you know, I was going to meet up with him at a random spot in the city, you know, and then take the application, take the job, blah, blah, blah. And then we're walking, right? And he said, oh, there's my mom right there. You know, because he's talking about moving to North Carolina, whatever. So I walk with him, go meet a mom. He said, I want to introduce you to my mom, whatever. So I go speak to him. Good afternoon, ma'am. It's nice to meet you. I know, good afternoon, miss. It's nice to meet you, whatever. And, you know, they're both quiet. So I lead a conversation. Matt William here. And he told me that he's good at dishwashing. Well, right now we're looking for a dishwasher. It's not much, but we can get them started between $8 and $10. It'll be a full-time position, evening, blah, blah, blah. I'm doing a whole spiel. And not only that, but one of the perks, and then she's looking at him like, oh, I don't know. I don't know. It's like she wanted to go with it, but she doesn't want to go with it. And at the same time, he's like, Mom, but I know we listen. He's like, talk, Mom, we could use this. We need this right now. Like, you can hear it in his voice, like the crying in his heart. Like, Mom, we need this right now, you know. And I said, not only that, but you know, if this is something that you're interested in, you know, on my end, I could put in a good word. I've been with the company for a while, but I would need some type of resume or something. And the mom's looking like they don't know how they're gonna do it. So I mentioned real quick as I see her shaking her head. I'm like, you know, but ma'am, you know, if y'all can get to a library and get someone to help with the resume or something, I just need something on paper about his work history. Then I can take that to you know, who it needs to go to, and I can get them started within a week. Not only that, but if y'all are interested in moving, which I heard, you could stay after 3 months, though. You know, you have to be to work on time. You have to have exceptional work, and just as some of the factors. But you have to work at least 3 months in great status. And after 3 months, you could transfer to a different property. So if y'all are interested in North Carolina, not only can you transfer after 3 months, but you're able to stay anywhere in the world for free as long as you book your hotel rooms in advance. Because where I work, you know, I mean, it's what's up. You know what I'm saying? It's some good perks with free hotel stays anywhere in the world. So it's really a blessing. All right. So, yeah, man, in so many words, it's not my power. I don't want to become proud. Don't get it wrong. This is not pride, you know, because it's not my power to give him the job. But we are vessels. We are vessels. We can be used to help people understand the love of the Most High. You know what I mean? Just like when you seen somebody in the front of you at the grocery store and they needed a quarter. They needed just one quarter or a few pieces of change to pay for their order. But they say, oh, you know what? I'll be right back. I don't have a dollar. I'll just be right. And you're right behind. Oh, don't worry about it. Here's a dollar. You know what I mean? We are vessels. That's a blessing for that family that needed that food. You know what I mean? If he's just dishwasher, it's a blessing that we have a dishwasher position. So for me, you know, your power could change lives. You know, your power could change lives. That's what it is. You know, just as well in the evil perspective, that the power that these sororities and fraternities change lives. Sometimes you could be looking for a job and you could be qualified. You wonder why you don't get it. It's because sometimes it's who you know. You know what I mean? It's going to be several other dishwashers that apply for this position. But since I've been working there for a while, now I'm not in a fraternity or sorority. Let me finish what I'm saying. I've been working there for a while, and this guy seems like an all right guy in my eyes and the spirit. So I want to put him on with a job before anybody else that I don't know. Just in the same light, these sororities and frats, sorors and frats, they're giving jobs to people who got the same ankle tattoo, who did the same burning of the coals and all this stuff, however they want to call it. You know what I mean? Did their little rituals. When they find out they're part of the same club, oh, really? Well, you should see how they talk when they see somebody they never know, they never even met, a part of the same club. I mean, they're like instant family the way they talk. It's weird. I see people from all over the world. It is weird. And they are like literally like bees. Alone, they seem like they have no value. But you hit a beehive if you want to. Hit a hive full of bees and see if you not get attacked. These people are a network, and they can get jobs anywhere. So they have the power to change lives. You understand? Satan even has the power to change lives. He's given the people in the world of stardom certain things and vices, you know what I mean, that seems good, even though their lives are changing for the worse, but it's being changed. But your power can change lives in some way, some shape or form. In some shape or form. All right? So, you know, you have to be generous. You have to have that power. You have to give sometimes in order to receive. The plug and the socket are the perfect fit. They're giving and receiving. They're, you know, oh, man. I hope this helps. All right. I am over an hour. I am over an hour. So that was today's show, you know. That was today's show. I'm not going to get into not on the mainstream news today. We could, but, you know, we'll just shorten it up today because I got some, you know, other things I want to take care of. But, you know, I hope you tuned in and enjoyed the show today. This one is 400. We're still at the 400-year mark officially. Officially, all right? We got to do some spring cleaning. We need to get ready for the Holy Passage, which we, those who are new to this, is to be celebrated on the dates between April 19th and April 27th. Starts on the evening of April 19th. Even though the dates are all mixed up, what we are to do is to have a feast. We are to eat good. So all my vegans, all my vegetarians, and you are considering yourself as righteous, disclaimer, in this world, I gotta put a disclaimer, but in the spirit world, in the world of the Most High, you are to eat lamb, and you are to get that lamb, preferably a lamb with unblemished, but since they took us away from our culture, we don't have land and things like that, we can't necessarily at our will just go to a farm and find an unblemished all white male lamb to cook, you know, and have with bitter herbs. But you know, you get a lamb and you definitely cook it on an open fire, all right? And then you have a feast. The Passover is a celebration of us coming out of Egypt, okay? It is such a blessing. And this is what it's all about, is to celebrate. You're not to work during this time. And some of you may already have obligations that you're scheduled or vacation. But if this is new, you know, to you, you know, just take that up with the Most High. You know, He understands your heart. You know, just pray it out, you know. Don't worry about that. Don't be stressed out. Like, oh, you know, and even though you're trying your best or this is new to you. But we are to eat lamb. Just have a feast. Have some fruits. You know, you're not supposed to eat anything with leaven in it. Anything with yeast. Okay? During this time. And we'll explain and get into that more. But I do have other videos. And there's tons of videos and different information that you could read on and look into in regards to that. Okay? I already did on my take on that previously. And I'm going to broadcast it live. My cooking and all that stuff, I don't know what I'm going to put on the menu, but it's going to be something. I'm going to do the thing. I already took the time off. I'm looking to get a whole lamb. That's what I'm looking to get into. And put that thing on an open fire if I can. I don't know how I'm going to do it or what I'm going to do exactly. But I'm going to make up a menu and we're going to be grubbing. Get my nieces and nephews and stuff and do the thing. But yeah, man, it's a time of celebration during this spring cleaning. It's time to refresh. Remember, if you had resolutions, you know, because you're that's what you like to do or whatever. You had some goals rather to, work out and to eat better. It's still time to work out and eat better. Drink more water and, you know, read up on scripture, you know, get in the word. You know, travel, spend time with family, eat good. You know, do what it do. You know what I mean? You can still do those things. But just stay committed. Try to be consistent, you know, if you can. And, let's get some cleaning done. Let's get our places spick and span. Go ahead and wash and wax your car. You know what I mean? Get it detailed. You know, get a update your wardrobe. You know what I mean? And get some clothes that are decent, you know. And, just try to do it in every which way, you know what I mean? Try to get some good Listerine and brush and floss, you know what I mean? If you're not good at flossing all the time, try to floss more, you know. If you don't make up your bed, try making up your bed more. You know what I mean? Set some small goals. And let's do the thing. The new year starts now. Passage is coming up soon. Passover is coming soon. Easter is not to be celebrated. It's a paganistic holiday. All right? But we are still at our 400-year mark. And with that being said, this is 400. And I love you much. Stay tuned. Real TV. I thought you knew my potential.
I'd rather work for y'all than working 9 to 5. We don't wanna work for y'all, we get our own job. The way you treat us when you wrong, you know you out of line. The way y'all treat us when you wrong, you know you out of line. Y'all don't love us. Snakes don't love us. Y'all really love blood. Y'all don't even trust us. Got us cooking in your kitchen, don't trust us. But anyway, see why Jordan Peele made the movie Us. See why he made the movie Get Out. Y'all really want us out. And it's coming out. And we coming up from 400. I hope you really want it. We coming up from 400. And it's all good. Hope you understand. Hope you got a plan. We coming up from 400. And it's all good. Hope you understand. Hope you got a plan. I see your little aggravation. Always trying to start an altercation. Must be your admiration. Always trying to start an accusation. And it's all good. When I saw 11-11, my affirmation, I didn't get so agitated. The Most High led me to you. So hopefully you can know the truth. I'm a sheep and you're a damn wolf. And we can care about your damn wall. Acting like you want some Adderall. Acting like you need some Tramadol. So radical. So radical.
And give him the praise. He's so worthy forever and always. And forever and always. And thank you, Yahweh, you save me. And I have to give you praise. Yeshua, you died for me. You were hung on a tree. Lord, forgive me my sin. Lord, forgive me for my sins. How wrong for what I did. How wrong for what I've done. I know that you're the one for me, the only one. And a lot of times we don't sing. So I sing this song for you.